Amazing. we shot till we dropped, and then we got up and shot some more. Had a good time, good fellowship with the Earwood family. Amen. Had a good lunch with them. And we found a really nice Mexican restaurant. They had a 98 sanitation grade. Praise the Lord. Amen. It's almost impossible to find that in a Mexican restaurant. I don't know if you did or not, but I didn't either, so my wife told me. But anyway, we had some good food, good fellowship, and appreciate the Lord allowing us to have that time together this evening. So we have a revival meeting the rest of the three more nights, Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night at 7 p.m. And so don't forget to pray earnestly and try to invite somebody to come be with us. Amen. We'll probably have some other preachers maybe drop in on us. And we have some threats of that anyway. So be here, be in your place. Amen. And ask the Lord to help us. It's not about them, it's about him. Amen.
Amen.
So let's ask the Lord to help us and help us to be a blessing to those around us. August 14th, Brother Jonathan Davis will be with us in the evening service. Continue to pray for Brother Jonathan. He's going off to Europe for 3 months. And we want to pray for him, pray the Lord bless him, be with him. He'll be with us preaching before he leaves. And then the 24th is our birthday fellowship. Don't forget about that. And we'll gather up in the fellowship hall on the 24th. We'll have some good fellowship. And so don't forget about that. That's at 7 p.m. on the 24th. And then King's Kids kicks back off on the 28th. Amen. We're going to have a great time there. The kids are excited about it. Amen. And looking forward to getting that fire back up. Hopefully this year we can build that. Amen. Get some more young folks in here. Pray about the band. Pray the Lord to help us with that. Have some funds that's already been given toward that. And so we're just praying God to help us find a good vehicle. Something we're going to have to work on every time it goes out. Amen. Just because I can't, don't mean I won't. Yeah. Amen. We'll find something that's good and dependable so we don't have to worry about the kids being on the side of the road. Amen. So we can make that a matter of prayer. Yeah. So, anyway, looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. And just pray earnestly, one for another. Amen. As I said this morning, I'll say it about the rest of the week. I want you to draw a circle around yourself and ask God to speak to everything in that circle. Amen.
Yes.
Well, I don't know about y'all, but Lord, help me this morning. Amen.
Amen.
I appreciate the message from the Lord. I mean, it was right on target. It was exactly what we needed to hear. And I look forward to tonight. Amen. And I feel him good at once. And so I know he's powered up, he's slept up, and he's rested up. And so you think that was good this morning. You wait till he gets fired up tonight. He's done eating. So anyway, we're going to have a good time. We're going to have some singing before that. I hope. We'll try to have some singing anyway. Miss Carolyn, you got a little song on your heart or on your mind tonight? I've got one on mine, but I'll share it. You sing yours and I'll sing mine. Let's put that up a little bit and stretch this thing out a little bit longer. I told Brother here, but I didn't want to use them like a ring of you. I mean, if they can sing, and I want them to sing as much as they'd like to, but I don't want them to sing every service and just wear them out. I don't want to do that. Hudson's trying to sing. He's about got tuned up.
Huh?
All right, we're going to try to sing. But anyway, you know, it was good back in, and it can get that way today.
Amen.
And I
just
thank you and praise you, you know, that before I got saved, I tried to hide behind people. And I would hide, and but I can't hide no more. Nothing like having that deep set of peace, amen.
Amen.
It's good to know that you're saved. Amen.
Amen.
I tried to sing a song the other night by myself and I made such a mess of it. So I'm gonna try to get the mind hope that I don't make a mess of it. I don't claim to be a singer, but I like to make a joyful noise.
Amen.
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 This is one of my favorite songs because it's not about me, it's all about him.
Amen.
So I hope you enjoy this song. I hope it'll be a blessing to you. If I can sing it all, I'll try to. You know the words to it, sing along with me. So it doesn't make it easier on me. Let the words speak to your heart. We serve a mighty God. Amen.
I mean, we
serve a mighty God.
Amen.
That can do exceed abundantly above all that we ask or think. He set aside some time this afternoon to spend it with us.
Man.
How about that?
How great
Bless his holy name.
Yes, sir.
Name is above every name. Amen.
Yes.
We can talk about a lot of things. The greatest thing we can talk about is our great, our God.
Amen.
The statement on rest like the
yes.
Yeah. Do not blot our names out of the book of life and just give us an opportunity to worship him and to serve him throughout all eternity. Sometimes I think, Brother Hero, I think sometimes we get to the misunderstanding of the teachings of the Bible. Oftentimes it's talked about going to heaven. No doubt the scripture mentions heaven and there's a place being prepared for us. Jesus said, where I am, there will you be also. And no doubt that the bride is being made up and is going to one day meet the groom. Amen. We're not staying there. The book of Revelation says we come back with him. Amen. Ride on a white horse with him to rule and reign with Christ.
Amen.
Amen. This is not just about making a trip on vacation, going somewhere to sit on a street of gold and kick up gold dust. That's not what it's about. Amen. It's about spending all eternity with King Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Ruling and reigning with him. In a place that the Father is always supreme. No sorrow, no sickness, no pain, no aggravating job staff to contend with. Amen.
Amen.
No devil have to deal with. I mean, for all eternity.
Amen.
Throughout all eternity. I don't think our minds sometimes can grasp that, all eternity. It's not like a short journey. It's going to be forever. And if there's anything in this world we can praise the Lord for, it's the fact that he's allowed us to be grafted in.
Amen.
We can be a part of him.
Amen.
What a blessing.
Yes.
How great he is. He didn't have to do that. Matter of fact, every time you pray, he don't have to answer.
Amen.
He don't have to answer. Because he's a merciful God and a loving God, he cares.
Amen.
And he does that.
Amen.
And he does speak to us. So Brother Hero was going to jump and open up your heart and let him speak to yours. Amen. Let him speak to you. Brother, come on. Smile the Lord.
Amen. All right. We're good. Amen. That thing's alive. Amen. Well, it's good to be back here in the house of the Lord tonight.
Amen.
I appreciate seeing some ones that were not here this morning. I am Dwayne Earwood. Good to meet you. Some I do remember from the revival, the missions revival, and so it's a pleasure to see y'all here tonight in the house of the Lord. I want you to take your Bibles tonight to the book of Genesis, chapter number 18. Genesis, chapter number 18. Amen. I want to read a few verses there, and while you're turning there, I just want to say I thank the Lord for the wonderful gift of salvation. He didn't have to save me, but he saved me in spite of myself. Amen. And then he called me to preach. And I'm just old-fashioned enough to believe that, listen, I did not get into the ministry for the money. I promise you that. Amen. But the Lord called me to preach. I still believe God puts a call on men. Let me clarify that right there. Amen.
Amen.
God puts a call on men to go and to preach the word of God. And you got to have that call. I'm convinced of that. And so I took me some college classes. And they gave me one of these master's degrees. And boy, it sounds all good and everything, you know. But can I tell you, amen, that don't help you preach at all. You got to have God, amen. And so I think the Lord, he called me to preach. And I just read that verse the other night where Paul said that he entrusted me. And he put me in the ministry. Amen. And I would not trade places with anybody. And I'm so glad you're here tonight. I want you to come back tomorrow night. I know this preacher does, and I'm hoping some others come in. He said there's been some preachers that are threatening to come and visit us. Amen. And that would be such a blessing. But tonight we're going to look here in the book of Genesis and try to bring out a thought about Abraham and try to encourage your hearts tonight, try to challenge your hearts from the Word of God. If you have found your place in Genesis chapter number 18, can you say, I am there?
I am there.
There's about three of you there. Is anybody else there? Amen. All right, would you stand with me and let's look here in the Word of God. I just got a few verses that I want to read, and then we'll have a word of prayer, and then I'll try to bring a few thoughts that I believe the Lord's laid on my heart for this evening. The Bible says in Genesis chapter number 18, beginning in verse number 1, says, "And the Lord appeared unto him," that is Abraham, "in the plains of Mamre, and he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. And he lifted up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground and said, My Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away. I pray thee from thy servant, let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet. Rest yourselves under the tree, and I will fetch a morsel of bread, and comfort ye your hearts. And after that ye shall pass on, for therefore are ye come to your servant. And they said, So do as thou hast said. And Abraham hastened into the tent unto Sarah, and said, Make ready quickly three measures of fine meal, knead it, and make cakes upon the hearth. And Abraham ran unto the herd, and fetched a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man, and he hasted to dress it. And he took butter and milk, and the calf, which he had dressed, set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree, and they did eat." Let's bow for a moment of prayer. Father, I want to thank you, Lord, that I had the blessed opportunity to be here at Midway Baptist Church. Lord, I want to thank you for this church and their support of the Earwood family. Lord, I want to thank you, though, for your presence here. I want to thank you, Lord, that in this place I believe that you are exalted, that Christ is magnified here in this place. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have, Lord, to be here on Sunday in the house of God. Lord, I thank you, dear God, Lord, for the opportunity to serve you with my life. And I pray tonight that you would take every heart in this place. You know where each one is spiritually, where each one is emotionally, Lord, in their life. And I pray, God, that you would give them something from the Word of God, not from me, but from your Word. Lord, would you make me a good minister of the Word of God tonight? We'll thank you and praise you for all that you do. And I do pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I do appreciate you standing in reverence to the Word of God. I find here, of course, Abraham. And if you'll read about Abraham, a lot of times we just call him, you know, the father of faith. A lot of times he's referred to, but, you know, God referred to him as the friend of God. Amen. Wouldn't you like to have that title? Amen. Be called the friend of God. Wouldn't you like to just be God's friend? Amen. You know what Jesus told his disciples? Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you to do. Amen. And so he's called the friend of God. I jotted down, I was just something hit my mind just a minute ago. I jotted down a couple of things that in chapter number 12, God called Abraham. Y'all know who Abraham was? He was a heathen.
Right.
Amen. I'm not being disrespectful. He was a heathen out of the land of Chaldeans. And they studied stars and they worshiped false gods.
Right.
And so God spoke to Abraham and said, Abraham, I want you to get up, and I want you to get out, and I want you to go to a place. Amen. Think about this. I want you to go to a place, and you don't know where it's at, but I need you to believe me. And did you know that our Bible tells us that God believed Abraham believed God, and God counted it to him for righteousness. Amen. So get a picture of this. Just imagine you're having your next missions conference. Abraham comes in. Amen. Missionary comes in. And everybody wants to know, said, man, what's your name? He says, my name's Abraham. All right, Abraham, you a missionary? I'm a missionary. Where are you going? Well, I don't know. Just God told me to leave, and I'm going to go somewhere. You mean you don't know where you're going? I don't know where I'm going. I just believe God. Amen. I tell you, it'd be hard to raise support like that nowadays. Amen. But he's a man that believes God. Not only that, he is, y'all, by the way, y'all remember when God called you out of this heathen world?
Yep.
Come on now, has anybody in here been saved by the grace of God?
Yeah.
Amen. I'm going to tell you something. Listen, some of my testimony this morning is I grew up in church. I mean, old-fashioned, hellfire, brimstone, pew-jumping, spitting Baptist preaching, and I thank God for it. Amen.
Amen.
I tell you, the first book that I ever remember reading in my life was the Bible. I told you this morning, I didn't know there was an argument over which Bible to use. I only had a King James Bible growing up. Amen. I mean, grew up in days of revival. I'm going to tell you something. I made a profession at the age of 10-year-old. Amen. But I was your typical rebel teenager. Amen. I turned 18. I got tired of people telling me what to do. And so I got smart and joined the service. Yeah, you can laugh right there. Amen. I joined the service, preacher. I got tired of people telling me what to do. I want to show everybody. And so I joined the Navy for 5 years. Amen. And so I go in the Navy. You know what? You ever hear all those stories about a sailor having a filthy mouth? Amen. And how wicked a sailor. And by the way, I wasn't even a sailor. I was a seabee. So we were even worse. That was me. I lived that life. Wicked. And I'll tell you, I got out of the service, preacher. Listen, I got out of service and I didn't want people to know how I had lived while I was in the service. I was ashamed. Some of those people didn't think that Dwayne Earwood would live that way, that wicked. And I went to a little revival meeting and I knew enough about God that he would deal with my heart. And I knew that I needed to get an altar and rededicate my life to God.
Amen.
You know what I did? I went to that revival meeting, all right. And God spoke to my heart, all right. But when I got up there on that altar, I didn't rededicate. So I started repenting. It dawned on me when I got in that altar that I could not live like the hell that I was living in and expect to go to heaven. And he saved me that night. Amen. And when he saved me, hey, he changed me. Amen. Y'all remember when the Lord got you out of that mess? My little kids, they sing a song. We'll have to hear them sing it one night. They sing a song. Andy is 12 and little man, he's 8. They got a little song that they sing. They sing, I missed out on the heartache of living my life in sin. And I'm telling you, that's the best testimony. And I tell some of our young people tonight, that's the best testimony you'll ever have. Amen. Is I've never done that. I've never walked that way. I never lived that way. That's the best testimony anybody can have. I remember living like a heathen. Amen. And God spoke to me. Abraham here is living in the land of the Chaldeans. God speaks to him, calls him out of that mess. When he called him out, he separated him. Lot went with him. Y'all remember that? Lot goes with him, but there come a time where God said, Abraham, I'm going to have to separate you from your nephew Lot. And so they split ways. I'm going to get to this chapter that I'm here, that I read to in just a minute. This is just all introductions. Everybody all right?
Yeah.
Usually I say that and about 3 people pass out. Amen. He separates them. I jotted down a couple of things. Bible tells us in chapter number 15 that he believed God. But did you know in chapter number 16... did you know that Abraham and Sarah, you know, it don't sound like they believe God.
Right.
They come up with their own plan. Y'all ever done that? I mean, you ain't got it to admit it. I'll admit it. Amen. I mean, I've done some stupid stuff since I've been saved. Say amen out there.
Amen.
I mean, there's been times that I thought, well, God really don't know what he's talking about here. So y'all ever have tried to help God out?
Yeah.
I have. Yeah. Abraham and Sarah, they got the bright idea. God must not know that Sarah is barren. So I tell you what, we're going to help God out. And so Sarah comes to Abraham and says, you know what, Abraham? You know, God must not really understand us. So why don't you take Hagar and why don't you take her as a wife? And maybe God is going to give you a seed. You know, that don't sound like a typical woman right there. Say amen right there. What's wrong with this woman?
Huh.
I'll tell you something. That goes to show us, and that this ain't the message, but there's a good message right here. That goes to show us, even after we're saved, we take matters into our own hands. We'll flat make a mess out of our lives.
Yeah, right.
Oh, yeah.
Oh yeah. We can be saved by the grace of God and get out of the will of God, preacher.
Right.
Now, later on, Sarah, she sees, later on in Genesis, she sees Ishmael making fun of Isaac when God did give him a child. Now she sounds like a natural woman. She says, that woman has got to go. Amen. And so they go. Chapter number 17. God comes to Abraham. Now get down to where we're going to get here in just a minute. Chapter number 17. Abraham is 99 years old. He's walked with God. He has got some experience with God. But God comes by and he says, Abraham, including yourself and every man, you are going to be circumcised. Y'all remember that? Did y'all know that God made promises to Abraham before he gave him the sign of circumcision?
Right.
You know what he was before he got the circumcision? He was a Gentile just like me and you. Amen?
Right.
But God marked it. Chapter number 17, God says, I'm going to mark you, Abraham, and separate you.
Right.
99 years old. Now, y'all know what circumcision is, and I'm not going to get graphic, but let me just put it this way. For our sake of application, it is a cutting away of the flesh.
Right.
That speaks to you and me spiritually. Abraham, 99 year old. You know what that tells me? Stay with me here. Because sometimes, and this is where I'm going with this message, sometimes we've been saved for a long time, and I told you this morning, God loves us too much to allow us just to put our life on cruise control until we get to heaven. But how many people do we know like that who just say, you know what? I'm just saved. I'm just holding on and holding out. And I tell you, there's more to life than that if you're saved by the grace of God. And you say, preacher, you don't know how old I am. Abraham was 99 years old, and God was still cutting the flesh off of him. You know what that tells me, by the way? I about done preached my guts out today and tonight. I don't know how we're going to do it the next 3 nights. Amen? Hey, that tells me that you ain't been saved too long to where God won't still cut some flesh away from you and still trim down and do some things in your life. Amen. Amen. Preacher, listen, can I just testify for a little bit? Hey, before I got saved, I lived any old wicked way that I wanted to. But after I got saved by the grace of God, amen, listen, in those churches I grew up in, they didn't preach standards and convictions to me, preacher. Amen, they didn't preach. They preached salvation is about all they ever preached. They didn't preach a lot of things on how I was to live my life daily. And so you know what God did? God, through the Holy Ghost, started dealing with me and through that Bible and then put me in the fundamental church and he started cutting the flesh away from me. I know this sounds horrible. I mean, I was saved. Matter of fact, when I was about 15 years old, I started smoking behind mom and dad's back. I started running around smoking. And I started smoking cigarettes. Did y'all know what? After I got in the service, I just kept on smoking. I smoked until I was almost, I don't know, about 2 months ago. Y'all pray for me. Amen. I'm just kidding when I say that. Amen. God got dealing with me about that. Those preachers that I grew up with, they didn't say nothing about smoking. Well, I don't want to smoke. I mean, I grew up in one of those churches where everybody right outside the church, right before church time, was flipping their cigarette out to go into the church. Right. Amen. Amen. I'm not bragging about that. I'm just saying that's how I grew up. God got dealing with me about that. God got dealing with me that if I went and I started trying to witness to people, that if I was going to go witness somebody, I'd make sure I didn't have those cigarettes in my shirt pocket. Because I didn't want them to. I knew better than that. And then I got to work. I mean, sometimes I'd go to church and I'd walk in there with a pack of Marlboro in my shirt pocket. I'm not being critical. If that is you, I'm not being critical. I'll tell you what God done in my life. God had to separate some things from it. When God, amen, when God started doing my heart about missions, I was still listening to rock and roll music. I was still smoking. I was still listening to country music. And I remember when I got an altar, I said, God, I don't even know what a missionary is, but if you can use me, here is my life. I went home that night. And back then, my late wife was laying there in the bed, and I couldn't go to sleep. I'd sit up on the edge of the bed. I'd get plumb excited. She said, what's the matter with you? I said, I gave our family to be a missionary tonight. And she says, what all does that mean? I said, I have no idea. I said, but I want to, glory to God. I still want to do something for Jesus. Amen. And I just want to do something for Jesus. And then I'd get depressed. You know why I get depressed? She said, what's the matter with you now? I said, you know what? I said, those preachers that are preaching that and go to the mission field and all that, no, they don't smoke cigarettes. I said, I'm still smoking cigarettes. I said, I still listen to rock and roll music. I said, and God was convicting me in death. You know what he was doing, man? He was cutting flesh away from me. Little did I know that there were some things that he had to get out of my life to get me ready to use me one day. So let me tell you something. If you're here and you say, well, preacher, you don't know me, and I still smoke cigarettes. Look, I'm not being critical to you, but I will tell you this, that if God puts his finger on something in your life and says, cut it out, there is a reason. And that reason is not to get mad at this preacher or get mad at God. It is to draw us closer so that he can use our lives.
Amen.
Amen. 99 year old, and God says, I ain't done with you. Cut that flesh away. Said now, chapter number 18, where I read, my introduction is over. Amen. Huh. And you know what, ma'am? When I read that verse just right there a while ago, it said that he sat in the tent door. I immediately thought of you because you about got me tickled this morning. Amen. Because I told them this morning, I'm praying that the Lord will supply everything for our tent. I said, and I just throw it out there for those of you who wouldn't hear of Sunday school. I said, the last time I went camping was in tents. It was a joke. Amen. And the preacher's daughter over there just got laughing so hard that she almost got me laughing too much. Amen. So then I get up and I read this text. I didn't even think about it. He's sitting in a tent. Chapter number 18. Abraham is 99 years old. God would show up at Abraham's house and just meet with him. Don't you like those kind of meetings? Amen.
Amen.
The last time that God showed up down there at Abraham's house, God said, cut away that flesh. And I tell y'all that hurt. I'm not trying to be an ugly preacher. Hey, sometimes cutting away our flesh, it hurts. I remember God had called me to preach. I was just pretty much doing everything I wanted to. I know this sounds horrible. I remember one day I walked out of my house. And listen, I grew up, I'm old enough to remember. I remember going to Kmart when I was just a little boy and go in there, and my daddy wouldn't have nothing on but a pair of shorts and no shirt. Y'all remember days like that? You used to go to Kmart like that. Well, I'd go to Kmart like that as I got older. I remember one day I walked outside, I was going to wash my pickup truck. I walked out and all I had on was a pair of shorts and no shirt or anything. And God the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, if you're going to be a man of God, you can't be out here half naked. And all of a sudden, I felt naked. Do you know what I did? Hey, listen, you know what I did? I didn't get mad, stoned, kicked, throw my bottom lip out there where everybody could trip over it. I went in the house and put some clothes on. Amen.
Amen.
Is that all right?
Amen.
Everybody all right?
Amen.
Abraham, the last time he saw God and talked to God, God said, cut the flesh away. So he shows up in chapter number 18. You would think Abraham sees God coming. You would think if that had been a lot of us Baptists today, we would have sat there in our tent door. You know what we would have said? Oh, man, what does he want this time?
last time I saw God, man, that hurt me. Man, what does he want now? Abraham don't do that. Do y'all know a lot of people, God start cutting flesh away from them, and they start running away from God.
Right.
Not Abraham. Not Abraham. Bible says he ran to God. Glory to God. You know why? Because stay with me. Stay with me. Is everybody listening? Because I promise you in your life, I don't know who I'm preaching to tonight, but I promise you in your life that if you just allow God to cut flesh away from you and you obey him, you will learn that he is doing it for your good and his glory. Amen. And next time he shows up with a preacher and he preaches the word of God, and yes, it might include you, and yes, it might cut, but I'm telling you, you'll learn that you'll run to God and not run away from him. God does not do things in our life to push us away. He does it to draw us closer, you see. And see, I know we live in a society, and I know we live in a day and age where people want a Christianity that involves no commitment. And we want people in our churches that are caving into a world that says, hey, we want a Jesus and we want the lovey-dovey Jesus that does not deal with our sin. But the problem is the cross dealt with sin. Amen. I mean, it's amazing. I listen, I get on the street corner and preach, and I get out there. Y'all know the number one verse quoted to me? It's like they don't read anything else in the Bible. Judge not!
Amen.
By the way, can I tell y'all something? You know who is historically, from my personal life, giving me the hardest time out there on the street corner preaching? Church folk. Church people. You know why? Because we have bought into this idea, oh man, we want to win people to Jesus, but we don't want to deal with their sin. But can I remind you that Jesus went to the well, and that woman said, I ain't got a husband. Jesus said, you're right, you've had five of them.
Right.
Oh, son, if that had been today, son, she would have walked off, called the NAACP or whatever it's called. She'd had her a lawyer. Oh, I can't believe he said that. I'm so highly offended. But he had to deal with sin, you see. God, when he cut away flesh from Abraham, Abraham has learned. He's old enough now. He understands. God done that for a reason. God is, glory to God. God has made me some promises. And when he saw God, Abraham runs. 99 years old. That joker starts running. I like to run. Lord willing, I told the preacher, Lord willing, I'll wake up in the morning. I do most mornings. I wake up and I either get on my treadmill or I go down to town and I'll take off running. I'll run about 3 miles. That's usually about what I get in, about 3 miles. I'll run 3 miles. Somebody says, without stopping. That's why I put something, but yeah, without stopping. Amen. I'll run 3 miles. I like to run 5Ks. I'll get out there and run. You know why? Because I like to eat whatever I want to. Amen. I mean, it's pitiful, but I use it as an excuse. Hey, but it's better than medication. Amen.
Amen.
So I get out and go running. Now, I enjoy it. I really do. I get out and go running. I figure I'm in pretty good company. Abraham, 99 years old. I hope I'm running when I'm 99. Amen. I hope I'm still getting out running 3 miles. Praise God. Amen. 99 year old. Amen. But get this. Abraham sitting in his tent door one day. He lifts up his eyes and he sees the Lord. He didn't sound like a lot of bad man. Another revival meeting. And we got church tonight too.
Huh.
Right? Mm-hmm. Abraham saw him and he got up. His son, he took off. And he's running. And he runs all the way over to the Lord. And when he gets there, you would think that when he gets there, he'd say, what do you want? What do you want this time, God? Man, last time I saw you, it hurt. What do you want now? Oh, no, he didn't say that. Oh, no, Abraham gets over there before God. And he just gets down on his face. And he says, my, notice,
my Lord, capital L-O, my Lord, you have come to see me. I, glory to God, I'm telling you, if you'll just let God work on your life. Well, when he shows up, amen, you'll just, hey, when he shows up, you'll just bow down before him, amen. He runs to him, he bows before him, amen. God showed up down there at Abraham's house, and Abraham goes to worship. Listen at that. Y'all ever worship God in your home?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Son, I used to drive a truck. So I tell everybody, my steering wheel saved by the grace of God. Amen. I've been spit and tears slung out on that steering wheel. God, show up, get in the cab of that truck. I'm driving an 80,000-pound vehicle. Probably wasn't the safest thing, but God was in there and it was like a cloud. Amen. Y'all ever worship down here in the house? Y'all have, have you? It ain't been too long ago we was watching Anchor Broadcasting Network up there in North Carolina. Well, we're here in North Carolina. Down there. Where are we at? Brevard. You know where Brevard is? Anybody know where Brevard is? Anchor Baptist Church. They raise their money. They go on, we watch them on TV there. So they'll get them singers up and preachers to preach it. One, I don't know who, I think it was the Agee family. Y'all know the Agee family? Man, the Agee family was up there. Man, I only got the, they got the touch of God on them. They got the singing. Son, I'm there in the living room. Woo! Hallelujah! But they couldn't hear me, but God could. Amen. Son, we're just right there in the living room. I praise God. Thank God. Listen. Hey, man, listen. When I hear about the blood, hey, I don't. Glory to God. It ain't just the church house I can get happy. Amen.
Amen.
I'm praising many times. Abraham's sitting in a tent door. Amen. He worships. He ran out there to him. Notice his discernment. I actually got some points I'm going to try to give you tonight. He's got some discernment. God shows up down there at his house. And I tell you, by the way, every age group has their own excuse why they can't serve God.
Right.
That's right.
The young people say, man, I'm too young. I tell my 8-year-old boy and my 12-year-old girl, you are not too young to start praying about the will of God now.
Right.
You're not too young to start serving God now. You know Brother Wayne Moore. He preached here. He started preaching when he was 10 years old. 10 years old was preaching revivals.
Right.
I've known that man a long time. So they ain't too young. But then you get on a little bit older. I'm picking on you. Because you can preach your son-in-law and you can't do nothing about it. See what I'm saying? See how that works up there? But we get me his age. We say, now, wait a minute. Man, I got a job. I got a wife. And say amen right there. Amen right there. Is that the loudest you can get right there? Come on, man. Hey, say amen right there.
Amen.
Go! Hallelujah. We fix that revival. Amen. You from the north? Okay, well. I'm just trying to figure it out. Amen. I'm just picking up. It's like I got a wife. I got a child. I got a house payment. I got a truck payment. I got a furniture payment. I got a diamond ring payment. I got a maybe a gun payment. I mean, I like, oh, but I mean, we got our excuses.
Right.
Then the older ones, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful or anything when I say older, just older than me. Amen. Which, by everybody out here. Amen. I'm just picking. Okay, I'm picking. We're too old. Abraham wasn't. Anybody here 99? Anybody here 99-year-old? Anybody 89-year-old? 79? Come on. 83. Hallelujah. 83-year-old? Not too old to serve God. Mm-mm. No, Miss Willie May said, no, that's not. No.
Amen.
Abraham, 99-year-old. Hey, when y'all get to, how 83? Hey, when some of y'all, when y'all get to 83, don't you still want God showing up down at your house?
Amen.
See, sometimes we get the idea that Christianity is, And listen, before I go any further with this, it's our fault that we have created this atmosphere that, hey, come and get saved. Hey, come and get saved. Come and get saved. And yes, we want to see people come and get saved. But too many times in our churches, we have seen people come up and get saved. Well, where's the next one? Come on and get saved. Come on and get saved. And what happened to that one? They got just kind of lost out and fell between cracks somewhere.
Right.
And that's how we have developed. And now we have created a generation that says, hey, I got saved and I'm just on my way to heaven. I'm just holding on.
Right.
And somewhere we missed that, no, there's a life in there to live. And not only is there a life in there to live, but now I've got to hand it down to somebody else. Have we not done that in the Bible Belt, really? Listen, you can pretty much be assured that if you meet the average person out on the street, 30 years old and younger, they do not have a Sunday school background like you and I grew up with. They probably don't know a lot of things that we just take for granted. Is everybody all right?
Amen.
There's things that me and you, we grew up on in church. And you ask somebody, hey, you know this, do you know? I mean, they can quote the books of the Bible to you. And if you added up all the messages that they've heard, all the Sunday school lessons that they've heard, I'm telling you, they probably have their own master's degree in theology and ask them to teach a Sunday school lesson, and they got locked on.
Right.
We didn't hand something down. Amen. I hope if the Lord lets me live to be 99-year-old, hey, you say, what you want to be doing? Well, I hope, number one, I'm still running. I hope I'm still preaching.
Amen.
I don't know about these guys that retire. Like the old preacher said, I almost want to get refired. Amen.
Amen.
Get fired up again. Wouldn't you like to be 99-year-old and be on fire for God? Amen.
Amen.
That's right. Abraham was. 99-year-old. That man took off a run. Worships God. He's got discernment that God showed up at his house. He says, my Lord, now if I found favor in thy sight. Look at what he says in verse number 3. Pass not away. Last time he saw him, he's cutting flesh away from him. But Abraham is saying, Lord, don't leave. Stay here. I like it.
Yeah.
Stay with me here. He is saying, God, I like it when you're at my house.
Yeah.
I like it when you're around me. Yes, I know you've hurt me. Yes, I know you've cut flesh away from me. Yes, I have walked through some valleys. And yes, I have suffered some heartaches. And yes, I have been through some stuff. But I have learned that when you show up, I love it. Hallelujah to God. Don't you just love it? I mean, I do. Y'all know that right now, I ain't talking about just going through the act of preaching. I'm talking about when I get to preaching, God says, right there, and just helps me, and he quickens this mortal body, and God gets on me. Can I tell y'all, I'd rather be doing this right now than anything that I know of.
Amen.
He says, God, I have learned. I like it when you show up down there at my house. He says, Lord, don't leave. Y'all ever been there? I have been. Y'all ever been in your prayer closet or wherever your place of prayer is? And some God get in there with you and you get to praying. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Them big old tears are just flowing down your face. Some. And there ain't nobody in that room but you and God. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Has it been a while since you've been there? Oh, see, you got real quiet right there. Has it been a while? Them big old tears rolling down your face. And I mean, it's like preacher mentioned it today. I mean, y'all know in there in that temple when God showed up, the priest couldn't even stand up. God's glory showed up. Y'all ever been in there? And it just seemed like God's in that room with you. I have been there, preacher, before. And I mean, I have been praying. And I've said, Lord, would you just put somebody else on my heart so I can pray with them? And I have literally said out loud to the Lord, Lord, let me stay here for a little while. Let me, Lord, I just love this. I love your presence. Lord, just let me stay right here. That's what Abraham's doing. Abraham got down before God and he said, God, don't leave. Don't leave. I like you being at my house. See, not everybody likes God showing up at their place. Because God starts showing up, some things start getting cleaned up, and this old flesh don't like that. But Abraham said, Lord, don't leave. Lord, I've learned to trust you. Lord, you, whatever you do to me is for my good. And I want my life to count for you. Have you been there lately? Have you ever been in that spot? Have you ever just got before God and said, God, just whatever you want. Whatever you want. I don't care what it is. I hate the back chat, but listen, if God puts his finger on something in your life, do not try to use that sorry excuse that, well, somebody else gets to do it. Because that was mine. I said, well, how them other preachers I know, they smoke. See, I mean, I was trying to argue with how they get smoked. Because God was wanting to do something in my life that maybe he knew he couldn't do in theirs.
Right.
Not that he wouldn't. But not that he couldn't. He just wouldn't go into it. Can I tell you? Get before God. I want to try to encourage somebody tonight. If you don't even use this altar tonight, I'm going to try to help you tonight. Can I try to help us tonight? Go home. I have learned, I have got me a spot at my house. We just moved there in December. And listen, I walk outside after dark. And behind my building back there, there's just a good nice soft spot of land, and I just walk back there, and it's just me and God. Do you have that place? See, if we don't have that place, then church just becomes a routine to us, and we do what we do because, well, that's just kind of what we're, but I'm telling you, there is a walk with God that I believe that there is a lot of church people that are missing out on. And I'm here to tell you, and I'm trying to encourage you tonight, don't miss out on it anymore. There is a life to live. There is a closeness to God. If you don't come to this altar tonight, you go home tonight and get away from your husband, get away from your wife, amen, and even if you got to say, hey, honey, you take the kids for a little bit, and then I'll take the kids for a little bit. I know how that can go. And sneak off somewhere. And don't worry about the time. And don't worry about that you got to get up in the morning and go to work. And don't worry about this. And just get close to God. Here's what the Bible says. Draw nigh to God.
Yep.
He'll draw nigh to you. Amen. You know why he was showing up down there in Abraham's house? Because Abraham believed God. And God counted him for righteousness. And God said, I can show up down there at Abraham's house. And he'll worship me. Hallelujah, God. Will you get off in that place? And I mean, just, can I help us tonight? Just get in the glory. Listen, we just got to get in the glory every now and then.
Right.
You think, I don't know what I'm talking about when I say get in the glory. I mean, you just get plumb beside yourself. And some people, you may not be jumping up and running or shouting. I mean, but you just get in the glory. Get in the fog of God. Get in God's glory and let him work on you. I'm telling you, there are some things that God can speak to you way more louder than what this preacher can. But you're going to have to find a spot. And Abraham had already determined that when God shows up, I'm going to get close to him. I'm going to fall at his feet. Amen. And so, you know, and so he runs to God. He falls at his feet. And he says, Lord, don't leave. Y'all know, not only his discernment, but y'all notice, let me put it this way. If we're going to do anything for God, church, we're going to have to hurry up and do it. Y'all know that the Bible, I got these words highlighted, and then run off and left my glasses. My daddy warned me. He said, you wait, one day you don't need them things. I said, not me. Daddy was right. Abraham ran in verse number 2. Verse number 6, and Abraham hastened into the tent unto Sarah and said, make ready quickly. Verse number 7, Abraham ran. And he gets a calf tender and good, and he gave it to a young man, and he hasted.
I highlighted those words. If we're going to do anything for God, we need to go on and do it. Can I encourage you tonight? I believe I'm talking to some hearts tonight, preacher. Here's what our flesh tends to do when we hear a message like this. Boy, that sounds good. I think I will. Tomorrow. Tomorrow. Boy, next church meeting. Oh, yeah. No, I believe I'm talking to somebody tonight. God. Satan, come on. Why is it that we can venture out on a lot of things in life, but the one we can trust him to save our soul from hell? Right. When it comes to somebody preaching about living by faith and just selling all out to God, or just, it's like, well, I don't know. Tomorrow. Can I tell you, Abraham's running. You know why? Abraham gets the sense, God is here. I don't want to miss it. He's going to do something. I mean, every time he showed up, he's doing something. As a matter of fact, he does something for Abraham here in this text too later on. He lets Abraham know, Abraham, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham starts bargaining with God. He says, God, if you find 50 down there, would you spare it? And he says, yeah, I'll spare it for 50. And he gets all the way down to 10. Y'all remember those verses? Right. That's later on in this chapter. And you know what? Abraham don't know that then. He just knows God is here, and I don't want to miss it.
Amen.
Don't miss it. Oh, man, there's the message right there. Don't miss it. Don't let your life. My dad warned me. I mean, you know, when I turned 40, I was like, man, I'm a 40-year-old. You know, I still feel like I'm 40. I don't feel like I'm 53. I still feel like I feel like I'm younger than 40. I do. It's just a number. But the numbers do add up after a while, amen. And my dad told me, he said, oh, man, boy, he said, you just wait. He said, 40's been gone just like that. Next thing you know, you're going to be in your 50s. Man! My dad's a prophet. What happened? Can anybody testify to that? What happened? And then come, God will speak to our hearts and say, hey, don't miss it. And we'll say, tomorrow. What is your life? It's a vapor. It's here for a little while and I don't want to miss it. And you know what? I believe God's put in my heart to come here tonight and tell y'all, don't miss it. Don't wake up one day and say, man, I was so busy with my career, and I was so busy doing this, and I was so busy doing that, and you're lacking spiritually. Don't miss it. I said it this morning. The only thing that we are going to do that really matters for time and eternity is what we do for the Lord Jesus.
Right.
Preacher, when we was there in the parking lot today, I don't know if you know those two boys there's out there, and they had them race car, the little remote control. And I said, hey, he's fixing the rate or control one of those things. And take, and so I told the little man, I said, look at that little car. And boy, I mean, that thing took off like a bullet.
Yeah.
You know what? Just that quick, the Lord spoke to my heart and said, just give them boys a gospel track. I grabbed a couple of gospel tracts out of the car there, and I got out, and I just talked to him about the car. I said, man, how fast was that thing going? He said, this one here would do about 68 miles an hour. Remote control car. Good night, man. I said, let me give you fellas something. You know why? You say, why? Is it not? I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss God speaking to my heart saying, give them boys a gospel tract. I don't want to wake up one day and be 7 years. I'll be 6. I want to wake up when I'm 60 and say, man, what did I do for the last 7 years? Now, you may not be the missionary. You may not be the evangelist. But you can be that witness.
Amen.
Right.
What I'm trying to
trying to say is don't miss it. There is a life to live in addition to getting saved. As good as that is, say amen right there. That's good, ain't it? There's a whole lot more. There's a whole lot more. Not a second work of grace or anything like that. It is giving our life to the Lord. It is walking by faith. Does the Bible tell us the just shall live by faith? And then, you know what? This ain't why I joined the Navy. But the Navy used to have their slogan, used to make Navy. It's not just a job. It's an adventure. Boy, was it. I'm going to tell y'all something. Living for Jesus. Oh, son. The Navy ain't got nothing on Jesus. Oh, yeah, man. I've stood out on the sidewalk and people throw rocks at me before, you know, and just do stupid stuff out on the street corner. And I just think, well, yay, that all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That's what the Bible says, 2 Timothy chapter 3. Mm-hmm. Right? We ain't scared of a little persecution, are we? Mm-mm. We ain't bought into this liberal crowd and we've kept our mouth shut and we say, well, we can't say anything about Jesus anymore because that crowd said that we couldn't. That's what they told them in the book of Acts. And they said, well, whether we obey God or you be the judge of that, but we gonna obey God. Why is it in 2022 we feel like, man, we've got to be shoved off in a corner? And as that's the church is shoved off in a corner and say, well, I can't say anything about what's going on anymore. That is nonsense. Amen. Don't miss it. Draw close to God. See if God don't give you a voice. See if God don't give you a witness. Amen. So when Abraham got to you say, well, why? Because it's going to inspire somebody else to get on fire for God. Y'all ever got around anybody that they make you feel like you want to do more for God? There's some preachers in my life, preacher, that every time I get around them, I feel like I ain't done nothing for God. But they inspire me to want to do more for the Lord. Y'all know some people like that? I've had some preachers tell me that before. You know what? That made my day. Because I don't feel like that kind of person. I do not feel like I do. But I've had some tell me, man, brother, here, wouldn't you just help me? You know, man, I get around you, I'm going to do something for God, man. You got that zeal and everything. I think, me? Man, no, I'm going to be like so-and-so. But if you'll inspire somebody else. Abraham runs into the tent and says, Sarah, hurry up. And make these cakes. Man, she got busy. Now, ladies, I ain't being critical right there. I mean, this is Abraham going in. That's his stove and his firewood, right? But he says, Sarah, get busy. Hurry up and make these cakes. Hurry up, cook something. You know what he's saying? God is here. And I don't want our family to miss it. We have an opportunity to serve the God of heaven. Glory to God. What an opportunity, Miss Willie Mae. To serve the Lord with our life. What an opportunity. Man, what an opportunity that God called you to preach. What an opportunity you have, man, to serve God with our life and say, Lord, here's my family. And honey, I mean, glory to God. I mean, listen, she lost a husband. I lost a wife. Our first four things on our list praying for somebody was, Lord, they gotta love you more than they love me. Then, secondly, Lord, they gotta love me. I figured that's where I was gonna get hung up right there. Amen. I figured that's where my problem was gonna be. Number three, Lord, they gotta love my kids. Amen. Amen. But number four was, Lord, whoever it's gonna be, little does she know she's gonna get to be the lucky one on this thing. Amen. But little did she know she's gonna end up one day with a missionary. So my prayer was, Lord, she's gotta be willing to go anywhere. You know what? Not long after we got married, we went and helped the church, and now I'm dragging her all over from here to Alaska, to Arkansas, to Wyoming, to South Dakota. We're going to Europe in January, and I'm like, come on, honey, we get to do something for Jesus. Hallelujah to God. Somebody says, man, these poor little kids, dragging them all over the country. Glory, I say glory to God, sir. My kids are going to get to go to the mission field in Europe and watch Daddy serve God. I want them to serve God. Amen. Is everybody all right?
Amen.
Hey, I don't feel sorry for Abraham in these verses, y'all. I've had some family tell me, man, you're crazy. I've had some church folks tell me that.
take them kids. They ain't got no steady home, always from here to there. Poor old Jamie. This girl grew up in Hendersonville, North Carolina. She ain't ever lived anywhere else. We got married. They say, no, she's living below Atlanta. I mean, she ain't moved in 150 years, okay? Amen. I mean, moving is not her thing. I can promise you that because I moved all that stuff. Oh, Lord help us. Moving is not her thing. We ain't been married 3 years yet, and we done moved twice. Amen. Somebody said, man, that poor Jamie. Folks in North Carolina down there in Hendersonville, they didn't want me to take her away. You know what they was praying? They was praying that God would call Brother Earwood to pastor there in that area so that they wouldn't lose her. And she wouldn't have, I'd have drove her all over the country. I mean, man, life really turned upside down for her. Now for me, I've been doing this. And I love it. I wouldn't trade places with anybody. I wouldn't trade places. And that's kind of tore her up. She's like, dear God, who did I marry? Amen. But you know what? I get to tell her just like Abraham told Sarah, Sarah, God is here. He's here. And we got an opportunity to serve him. Come on, hurry up, hurry up. And then Abraham runs. He runs out here to the herd. He gives him a calf, young and tender. He runs it over here to this young man. And he says, hurry up and make this, hurry up and dress it. God is here. And I don't want to miss anything. I don't want to miss it. God is here. We got a chance to serve the God of heaven. And he gets that, and he gets those cakes, and he gets that butter, and he gets that calf, and he goes out, and he sets it before him. And I swear I wish I had a handkerchief now. Because what I would do, God sits down to enjoy what Abraham has done for him, and Abraham stands there while they eat. Now imagine as he takes maybe a waiter's towel or a handkerchief and puts it over his arm, he's like, whatever you need, Lord, you just say it. I'll get it for you. What a life. You say, man, Abraham was a wealthy man. I'll tell you what he was wealthy in more than anything. He walked with God. He'd stand there and he'd say, God, if you need anything. You say, I don't know what to say when I get in front of God. If I just get along with God, just get before God and say, God, if you need anything, can I be the one that does it? He gets before God and he says, God, don't leave. If you need something, can I be the one that gets it for you? Don't y'all, you do that for your wife, right? Say amen right there. Anytime I order to eat, I try to make it a habit. I say, if I'm getting up or something, I'll say, you need anything? I'll get it for you, my love. She does that for me too. Well, what a privilege. We get to go to the God of heaven and say, you need anything? Lord, what can I do for you? Abraham. Later on in that chapter, you'll find that God says, I'm going to let Abraham know what I'm fixing to do to Sodom and Gomorrah. Put that all in context with our world today. God's fixing to come back and he's bringing judgment just like he brought on Sodom and Gomorrah. And God says, but I know Abraham. He'll raise his kids for me. He will command his house for me. I'm going to let Abraham in on some things. Hey, I'm trying to encourage some people. Would you stand in that, ma'am? Would you, Miss Christine? Would you come to the piano, please? I'm trying to encourage somebody to not just slip up and get close to God. And listen, and I know, we are in a Baptist church. We are in a revival meeting. And I know, give an altar call. We have a good response. People coming to the altar today. I say, praise the Lord. Sometimes people just don't want to do that. I say hallelujah if we do. And you say, man, I don't know. We worry about what people are thinking about us too much.
Right. Amen.
I can't go over that altar. I don't even want to know what happened. You're going to have to get over him. You're going to have to just get you a good old case of, I can't help it. What somebody don't think. You say, well, I ain't come up here to all tonight. When you get home tonight, you slip away and get alone with God and say, God, is there anything you want to cut away from me? Is there anything you want to do in my life? Is there anything? Lord, is there anything in my life that you would want to get rid of so that I could be more used to you? Is there anything that I'm doing? Is there anything I'm not doing? And you speak to my heart that I could just serve you with my life. So you start talking about that around a bunch of Baptist people, so people start getting nervous. But what I'm talking about is a life that refuses to settle for just sustaining and getting by. But it's a life that lives out of faith that God put in there. And He wants to develop more and more in our life as we trod this path, man. Would you stand with me? While she plays, if you need to use this altar, if you want to come and pray about something, right now would be a good time to come and pray about it. Lord, what can I do for you? Is there anything, Lord, that you want to get rid of in my life? I need to come and pray while she plays. We'll wait. She's playing little as much than God is in her. You say, well, I ain't much. Just get God in. Hey, man. I ain't a whole lot. A little is much when God is in. Amen. How about it tonight? So I'm going to pray. What about that? These young ones up here. Oh, good. A lot of times that show us up. You know, there's a reason why Jesus said such a little children come unto me. Because they liable to just believe God when those grown-ups want. Oh yeah. They liable to just say, oh, my little kids, I mess with them a lot, but I'm not telling them anything. They'll believe that. You know? What about that? They just believe God and just say, well, that's what God said. So it's got to be true. That show us up sometimes, Lord. Amen.
I'll go. I'll do it.
I think, Brother Wayne, the reason why we don't see a lot of that is because people are afraid of what God will have them to do. I've had people tell me, well, I would surrender to the work of the Lord, but I don't want to go to Africa. Listen, God knows who you are. God knows where He can use you. And God knows that if you don't want to go to Africa, He can't use you. But He also knows He can change you. I'm afraid that there's been so many that's missed the blessings and the will of God. Let me just bring it right down to where we all be. Every one of us that are saved by the grace of God, there's a soul somewhere weighed in the balance. And God says, I need you. I can't use nobody else because they won't hear nobody else. But I know they'll hear you, and I need you. When God knocks on your heart's door and shows you some things you need to get rid of, you want to get rid of it. What's it worth? It's worth whatever it costs. I'm 100% convinced that God wants to do something with Midway Baptist Church. You'll never change my mind. I'm 100% convinced. God needs us as a church, collectively, individually, with our personal devotion to the Lord, but then collectively together, God needs us as a church to say, "Here, am I. Here, am I. Lord, use me. Lord, help our church be a shining light in this community. Help our church to be an impact in our state. Help our church to be an impact to the homes that we represent." Oh, preacher, if I do that, I might have to change my way of living. What's it worth? I might have to quit some things. What's it worth? My wife and I, years ago, we started into the girls' home ministry. I surrendered to the call to preach. Told the Lord whatever He wanted me to do, I'd do it. Before I got out of the church that Sunday morning, the choir leader met me about halfway down the aisle. He said, "When are you going to start?" I said, "Start." He said, "Being the youth director." I don't know nothing about a youth director. But I surrendered that morning to do whatever the Lord wanted me to do. So he put me in as youth director, and I did that for about 5 years. And then I told my wife, I said, "I just believe God wants us to do more." And my wife looks at me and says, "I don't want to have to move. I don't want to sell our home. I don't want to do those things." She said, "But whatever God wants us to do," there was a problem. I didn't want to sell everything. I didn't want to move to Africa either. And we both prayed and we read our Bibles and we prayed and we asked God to show us and teach us. And then we came together one day and said, "You know, God's taught me something." I said, "What has God taught you?" She said, "You always told me that I don't have to sell my home. I just got to be willing to sell it. I don't have to give up anything. I just got to be willing to do whatever it is He wants me to do. And if God put His finger on it, we got rid of it." And God put us in the girls' home ministry. We did that for about 5 years. God led us from that to another church. We sat under for 2 years to help that church. They helped us, we helped them. And then God opened the door for me to be a pastor. Started to work and stayed there for 8 years, and God put us in. Look what God has done. My soul in and I'm dropping a hat at what God can. I just want to encourage you, don't miss it. There's nothing in this world that's worth missing the blessing of God. Nothing. Let it go. Let it go. I used to smoke too. Some of y'all would be surprised when you hear that. I used to smoke like a steam engine. Amen. Love that mess. But before God called me to preach, before God ever put me to youth ministry, before God ever did anything in my life, He pinpointed that thing. Since then, you got to quit. And I got a little nervous because I got to where I couldn't breathe well. And I hurt my chest sometimes because I was smoking with cowboy killers, Marlboros. And God began to convict me. And He said, you need to get rid of this. And I had a friend of mine that says, look, he wanted to quit dipping, and I wanted to quit smoking. And so we made a pact between each other. We hide our stuff in our vehicles, and we locked the vehicles up, and we swap keys. And we had to get each other's permission in order to go to the car to get us some nicotine. God used that in my life to get that out of my life. Whenever I got that out of my life, God opened the door and started convicting me about being a Christian. That's the way He did my life. He did His life different. I'm telling you, God can't do in your life what God wants to do if there's something there that's going to hinder your work. Cut it out. Get rid of it. And watch. Look at what God did with Abraham. Blessed his seed, made him a great nation, kept every promise he ever made.
Yes, sir.
He'll keep every promise he's ever made. Preacher, you mean if I do this stuff, God will forsake me? He said, I'll never forsake you. If I quit doing this, God won't leave me. God says, I'll never.
Amen.
I'm not ready to preach and say,
amen.
God said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you.
Oh, yeah.
If you'll do this for me, amen. There's always a promise, but a condition to be met before you get the blessing of the promise. If you'll meet this condition, God says, I'll do this. Preacher, I'm scared. 365 times, God says, fear not. Fear not, for I am with you. I don't know what it is that God's with you today. I don't know what it is tonight that God's put me on, but I do know God sent us all a message. It's not by happenstance that you're here. It's not by coincidence that you're here. It's not by some coincidence that they preach what he preached. Whatever it is, don't miss it. Don't miss it. I got one more thing I want to tell you. I'm trying. But Dwayne said this morning, he's trying to quit. It's hard. Sometimes. I'm going to share this with you guys in a meeting. I was preaching revival week myself. I had a girls' home ministry and it was asked to come preach a revival. That meeting started out, I'm in the churches in advance. And I was praying every day, God, please help me get there. First night of the meeting, God put me in a place just to plow the ground in. And I just tried to obey God. I'm not bragging on myself, just listen to it. I preached the word of God. And there was folks all over the altar. Some were mad, some were crying. Some on the altar. Come back the second line, and God gave me another message, and I preached right down the same lines. And my dad was singing, my dad was home, and my dad was just being right with God. And on the first night, on Monday night, there was a lady there, she left. She went home mad at the preacher. And she went home and she dwelt on what the preacher said. And God convicted her heart and she got on the phone for 16 years. She hadn't spoken to her daughter. And that night she got convicted, God dealt with her heart and she went home. She picked the phone. And she called her daughter that she hadn't spoken to in 16 years over some pettiness. And she apologized to her daughter. I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. And she came back to the church on a Wednesday night. And I preached to you. And God moved into service. And she fell on the altar. And she said, it's me, oh Lord. And she fell on the altar and begged God to forgive her for hindering the work of the service. She said, God, forgive me. And she announced it from her seat. She said, I'm the one. God, I'm the one that's hindered the and she testified of what was between her and her daughter. She said, I went home and she said, God convicted me and I called my daughter and I made things right. I told some of you had revival. People started getting right with God. She got right with God and she been praying that her husband would come to church. For years she prayed her husband would come to church. That Friday night, the husband walked in the back door. That Friday night, her husband came to church, but her son got saved on that Friday. Amen. So there's mom and daddy in church. Dad still don't know much about church, but son know what it was to get in the Holy Ghost. And her son got saved because she got right with her daughter. See, whatever it was, she got right. And her son got saved. The meeting was supposed to stop on that Friday night. But me and the preacher told us, I don't think God's done it. And he said, preacher, I know God ain't done it. He said, I've had phone call after phone call. God's dealing with some folks. God's not done with this meeting. Can we come back Saturday night? Which is unusual. I like it when God does. Yeah, that's serious. We come back on Saturday night. We come back on Sunday. Two meetings on Sunday night. Come back on Monday. And God was working. I'm talking every night. Folks are talking about this is little Jim. And I told you, I was talking about little Jim. I said, on the other side of the church, every time we give an invitation, he's an older saint of God. He said, you better get in while the waters are troubled. What that meant was if God's moving, then you got something you better get in on. Indeed. Amen. He'd say, every service I give it into, and he'd say, second week of the meeting on Friday night. That daddy walks the aisle. Mama got right. Is everybody listening? Mama got right and got right with the daughter and son got saved on the first week. Daddy comes to the meeting on that Friday night when son gets saved. On the second week of the meeting, we ain't supposed to be. It's not even scheduled, but we're just away. And daddy gets saved and walks down the aisle. Amen. Ask Jesus Christ to be his Savior. Because one lady gets it right and gets that whatever it is out of her life. And son gets saved. And daddy gets saved. That is a family that's serving God. Yes. Because one said it's not worth it.
Right.
It's not worth it. That meeting went for three solid weeks. Nine folks in the church members. Nine church members got saved. 13 people that was in the church as preacher have never got baptized. Now I'm out of the will of God. I need to get baptized. Because one person, this one person, I want God to show the bias. I want God to show it all in my secret place.
Oh, yes.
I need it. I want him in my lives. And when he gets there, I don't want anything to hinder him. I want him to stay in my life.
Oh, yes.
God, please. Just stay. God, don't. Listen, church folks, your pastor's prayer is that God will show up in your place. But other than just your place, my place, I want God to show up here.
Amen.
I don't want him to leave.
Right.
I want the sinner to pass by the roads and hey, there's something going on inside that place. Let's go see what it's all about. Pull up in here and get a Holy Ghost conviction and just get full of God and say, I want to be a part of that. Amen. God don't believe. God don't believe. Throw the clocks away. Throw the schedules out the door. Because you can't schedule God.
Right.
Brother Sammy Allen said one time in a meeting. Brother Sammy got up and I don't know. We've been in the meeting for about 4 hours. No, Brother Sammy got up and he said, I'm going to tell you what. If you'll get rid of that clock, just get a good dose of the Holy Ghost. When you get up in the morning, you'll feel like you've been refreshed and you'll never know how long it had been. I'll testify to that. If you get where God's at, there's no such thing as time. If we stay the midnight, and you'll think, preacher, I got to go to work. You'll get up in the morning, and you'll be just as fresh as you were if you'd slept 8 hours.
Amen.
Little as much. tell you. You can't, I can't explain. You have to experience. You have to know. You've got to say, God, I want to feel that presence. I want to be prepared. I want you in my presence. I want to be the one to be like Abraham. He says, Lord, is there anything I can do for you? Is there anything, Lord, that no wretch like me can do for you? Anything at all? Help us to surrender. And here it is. Here it is. One last thought, Linda.
Maybe thinking, preacher, I don't have much to give. If the Lord were to show up and were to come to where I'm at, I don't have a whole lot to offer. This is what God says. All I want is you. That's all I want. All I have is me and my flesh, my wicked ways, my evil thoughts. It's all I have. God says, it's all I want. Just want you to give.
Bless his holy name.
Amen.
Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. All this with him. Bless his holy
name. Amen.
Oh, yes. Bless his holy name. Glory to his name. Bless his holy name. Saved tonight?
Amen.
Are you saved tonight?
Amen.
You look back and see where God brought you from. Lord, help us with that. Don't do something for us. Has God blessed your life? I can't help but think of all the time. He's never, it's never failed me.
That's right.
And he never will.
Amen.
He's blessed me beyond measure. I'll be honest with you tonight. I felt the good presence of the Lord. I just don't want him to leave.
That's right. Amen.
God's done great things in my life and your life. Just sometimes he shows it to me. Goes away. He just rolls back the curtain. This is where I brought you from. Look what I've done in your life. I couldn't be in hell. I couldn't be in jail. I could be one of those out on the street from home to side. Says homeless. I could be one of those struck out on drugs, laying in the hospital bed, about ready to die. That could be. Y'all said. Look what I brought you for. Look what I've done for you. You remember this? Oh, hell, boy. I remember that. You remember this? Oh, yeah. I remember that. Just a little over a year ago, God says, you remember that? What I forgot. I ain't forgot what you've done for me.
Amen.
God says, I'm not
have
all the time. Enjoy it.
God said, I'm not done with you.
Amen.
Bless his Lord.
Amen.
I don't care what anybody else says, or what the president says, and all the United States says, or what the lawyers say. It ain't over if God says it's
over.
If God says shut the door, we'll shut the door. But until God says shut the door, we shut the door.
Amen.
If God says stop preaching that book, we'll stop preaching that book. But until God says stop preaching it, I'm not going to stop preaching it.
Amen.
If God says stop sending the missionaries, stop sending the money, we'll stop. But until God says it, we're going to keep going.
Amen.
Amen. If God says continue to speak through Thursday night, guess what we're going to do? We'll be here Thursday night. Preacher, that's not what we got planned. Throw those plans out the window. Let's just obey God.
Amen.
Amen. If God says let's have this meeting all through the weekend into next week, or somebody needs to do something for God. Somebody needs to get something right with God. And it don't always happen on the first three nights of meeting. We talk about God in a box. And say, God, if you can do it in 3 days, let's get it done with God. If you can't do it in those 3 days, then we're just forgiven. What if God wants to do it in the next week, not this week? If God says go to next week, we'll go to next week. Richard, it must cost us. What's it worth? What's it worth? Richard, I got to work. What's it worth? I got to work too. What's it worth? I might have to call in sick one day. I might have to take a day or two off. I've got a medical emergency. My heart's in trouble. Hello? I've got a medical emergency. My spiritual life is going down the tubes. I've got to do business with the doctor. And his name is Jesus Christ. Whatever it takes. Is everybody with me?
Amen.
I told y'all when this thing started. Before it started, I told God wants to do something. I'm convinced of it. And it may not happen in 3 days or 4 days. It may not happen in the first week. Preach, what we're going to do, we're going to pray. We're going to ask God. What is it? What does it mean? Well, you know what they say when those disciples gathered around the Lord? The Lord said, one of y'all betrayed me. And they start going around the table. What does it mean? What does it mean? And the one that was gifted knew who he was. He knew who he was. We don't have to ask. We know God's already convicted the hearts. God's already done his work. It's up to us. What does it mean? What does it mean? God doesn't always work in our time. God doesn't have to work in our time schedule. We can't schedule God. We have a meeting scheduled to have a meeting. Brother Wayne, I told him that you can't bring any man. No man can bring revival. He knows that any reason, no man can bring revival comes when God's people get to the place in their life where they want to be revived. I want to do what God would have. Whatever it is.
Amen.
Whatever it is. It may just be as simple as just be faithful and be there and pray. That may be the only thing God wants you. Just be there in your place and be faithful and pray. It's all God's asking of you to do. That seems mighty small, but for
for some of this, it's a big task. It's a big task. I can't dismiss. I don't have any to dismiss the service. But what I am going to do is I'm going to unplug till tomorrow night. And I'm pleading with you, as church members, as visitors, that you're here tonight, you don't have to be a member of Midway Baptist Church to get back in with this meeting. You're more than welcome to be here. But for the members, I want you to go home and I want you to soak in and soak up what we've had tonight. And find you that little secret place and ask God, what is it that you will be here? Lord, you're here. Is there anything that a wretch like me, thy servant, that's what Abraham said, thy servant, is there anything I can do for you? Go on tonight and ask the Lord. Be praying for me tomorrow night. Let's see what God has in store for us. Amen? Let's see what God has in store. Our Father, Lord, I bless your sweet, loving, precious name. May glory and honor, power and majesty be to thy name. I thank you, Father, tonight for your presence in this place. I thank you, Lord, for the messenger and the message. And I thank you, Lord, for how you spoke to my heart as a pastor. How you spoke to my heart as an individual, as a born-again believer. Lord, tonight, at the Midway Baptist Church, I ask you, Father, what is it, Lord, that we can do for you as thy servant? Help us, Lord, as we go our separate ways tonight and then out through the day tomorrow, Lord, to do whatever it is that is well-pleasing in your sight. And do that thing, Father, that you would have us do. If there's anybody here that's sent under the message tonight, Lord, in your presence, God, that has something in their life, Lord, that you have pinpointed. I pray for that soul, Lord, tonight and throughout the day tomorrow, Father, that they would get that thing settled, Lord, with you, and they would come back, and Lord, be in your presence and in your grace and in your mercy, Father, and your will, and be ready to accept the blessing that you have for me. For settling whatever it is in their life. May your will be accomplished, may your will be done as we depart and return to you. Protect us as we travel. Lord, be with those who are sick. Lord, I pray that you give them strength. Those that are weak, I pray that you give them strength to be able to come back tomorrow. Be in this service. Your will accomplished, your will done is our prayer. Jesus, loving, sweet, precious, and holy name we pray. Amen.